So the first topic is family planning. What is family planning? Family planning refers to the practices that help individuals or couples to attain certain objectives. That is, family planning refers to practices that help couples attain certain objectives. What are the objectives? Number one, avoid unwanted births. Number two, do wanted births, bring about wanted births. Number three, regulate interval between births. Number four, determine the number of children of the family. So what is family planning? If I ask you the definition, then this is the definition. Family planning refers to the practices that help couples to attain what? Avoid unwanted births, bring about wanted births, regulate interval between births, and to determine the number of children, exact number of children that they want. So this is the definition of family planning. Next, we come to the topic scope of family planning. If I ask you, what is the scope of family planning services? First tell me, is family planning equal to birth control? Is family planning equal to birth control? Is family planning equal to birth control? The answer is no. Why? If this entire thing is family planning, birth control is only a part of it. So, family planning in reality is a much more broader concept than birth control. Now, tell me, what is eligible couples, what is target couples, and what is couple protection rate? The first thing is eligible couples. What are eligible couples? Eligible couples refers to currently married couples wherein the wife is in the reproductive age group. That is, currently married couples where wife is between 15 to 45 years. That is eligible couples. Here, this term currently is very important. Currently married couples where the wife is between 15 to 45 years. So the eligible couples. The eligible couple, government has got one register called the eligible couple register. Where is it maintained? Government has a register called the eligible couple register. Can you tell where it is maintained? It is maintained at the sub-center. Now if I ask you, who maintains it? The answer is female health worker. The female health worker in the sub-center maintains the eligible couple register of that locality. Next is, what are target couples? If I ask you what are target couples, in order to pinpoint the couples who are a priority group within the broad definition of eligible couples, the term target couple was coined. Who are target couples? Basically, couples who already have 2 to 3 living children. Means 2 to 3 living children. So, couples who already have 2 to 3 living children, they are considered under the category of target couples. Now, we know that if these are the number of eligible couples, then the number of target couples will be this one. Then the target couples, number of target couples is a subset of the eligible couples. When eligible couple will be all the currently married couples whose wife is has the age between 15 to 45 years. Whereas target couples are those couples where the wife is between 15 to 45 years and they are currently married and they will be having 2 to 3 living children. That is your target couple. Next is couple protection rate. What is couple protection rate? It is defined as the percent of eligible couples protected efficiently against childbirth. Means percentage of eligible couples protected against childbirth. So what is couple protection rate? This is the percentage of the eligible couples protected against childbirth. Now, statistically it has been seen that if couple protection rate is greater than 60, then only net reproductive rate of the country can be equal to 1. And when net reproductive rate is 1, it will be equivalent to 2 child norm. Next are the contraceptive methods. So we start the heading, broad heading of contraception. Now, tell me, what is an ideal contraception? First of all, can there be anything ideal in this world? The answer is no. There is no such thing as ideal thing. No ideal gas. Every ideal thing is not present. So ideal contraceptive, not present. Okay? But what are the characteristics of ideal contraceptive? It will be safe. It will be effective. It will be acceptable. It will be cheap. It will be reversible. It will be simple to administer. It will be long lasting. It will be independent of coitus. Sexual intercourse. And it will not require any medical supervision. So what are the characteristics of an ideal contraceptive? It should be safe, it should be effective, it should be acceptable to the society, it should be cheap. It should be safe, because if the safety of the mother is compromised, then nobody will use it. It has to be effective, because if the failure rate is high, then once again it won't be popular. It has to be acceptable, means if the contraceptive method is so embarrassing for the person, then obviously that the patient will not use it. So it has to be acceptable. It has to be cheap. It has to be reversible. Means the patient should be able to reverse it whenever she wants to get again pregnant. It has to be simple to administer. It has to be long lasting. It has to be independent of sexual intercourse. Because if it interferes with the sexual intercourse, then obviously it won't be popular. And it should not require 2 months of medical supervision to use. So these are the characteristics of an ideal contraceptive. So, now the government of India has realized that there cannot be any ideal contraceptive. So what they are doing, they are basically now promoting what is called as the cafeteria approach. Means, just like when you go to a cafeteria, they will give you a catalog. When you go to a cafeteria, they will give you a catalog where the catalog will contain, suppose this one costing 50 rupees, this thing costing 60 rupees, this thing 70 rupees. Like this, they will have a huge number of lists of foods which they have. Similarly, the cafeteria approach is used in for contraception nowadays. So what the government is doing is that family planning programs will provide choice of various methods to the individual or to the couple. And the couple may use whichever they want. So that is the cafeteria approach. Now, I'll give the list of the various contraceptive methods. And this list, according after explaining this list, then I'll go to the details of the various contraceptives. So, contraceptive methods. First is, this side heading will be facing methods. This side heading will be terminal methods. Terminal methods, you know only, it is sterilization. This side heading will be facing methods. This side heading will be terminal methods. What are the terminal methods? They are the male and female sterilization. So, these are the two types of contraceptive methods. Heading, broad heading. Now, under spacing, the first broad heading that comes is barrier method. What is the barrier method? Here you are creating some barrier between the male and the female. So, example, this again has two types. One is physical, another is chemical. So, physical is condom, physical, this is both male and female, then there is diaphragm, then there is vaginal sponge, and under chemicals, there are foams, there are creams, suppositories are there. Then number two heading is intrauterine device. Okay. Number three is hormonal contraceptives. What are the hormonal contraceptives? Number one are oral pills. What are the oral pills? Combined oral contraceptive. Progesterone only pill. Postcoital pill, that is emergency contraceptive. Then male pill. Okay. What are the next? There are depot formulations. Depot formulations. Means you don't have to give it regularly. After some, you can give it for some time and then it will be stored as depot in the body. There are injectable methods and there are subdermal implants, vaginal rings. injectables. Subdermal implants, then there are vaginal rings, okay, then B is post contraception methods, what are they? Menstrual regulation, menstrual induction, oral abortifacient, abortion, and then there are others. Under others, we have abstinence, coitus interruptus, we have safe period, a rhythm method. Then there is breastfeeding method, then there is birth control vaccines, and then there are natural family planning methods. What are the natural family planning methods? Basal body temperature, then there is cervical mucus method, and then there is sympathermic method. I'll repeat now. Now this is the broad headings of the various methods of contraception. So, contraceptive methods are of two types: spacing methods and terminal methods. Spacing methods means there is space, they increase the space between two pregnancies. And terminal methods means terminal, permanent solution. That is sterilization, male or female sterilization. What are the different spacing methods? Barrier methods. Heading one is barrier methods. Intrauterine device, hormonal contraceptives. Okay, this is postcoital pill, post contraception methods, PCM stands for post contraception methods, and there are others. Now under barrier, there are physical barrier methods, chemical barrier methods. Physical barrier method is condom, male and female, diaphragm, vaginal sponge. Chemicals are foams, creams, suppositories. IUDs are there. Under hormonal contraceptives, it can be oral pills or depot preparations. Oral pills can be combined OCP, progesterone only pill, post contraception pill, this is male pill. Depot preparations can be injectables, subdermal implants, SD stands for subdermal implants, SP is subdermal implant, V stands for vaginal rings. Then, under post contraception methods, this is MR stands for menstrual regulation. Menstrual regulation, MI stands for menstruation induction, menstrual induction, OA stands for oral abortifacient, A stands for abortion. Others is, A is abstinence, sexual abstinence. Next is CI, is coitus interruptus. This is rhythm method or safe period method. SP is safe period method, rhythm method. Next is VF, is breastfeeding method. BCV is breast control, BCV is birth control vaccine, birth control vaccine. Then there is NFPM, natural family planning methods. Natural family planning methods. These are of three types: basal body methods, cervical mucus, CM method, and then there is SM, symptothermic method. Symptothermic method. So, first I will talk about, from this chart only I will explain anything. So first of all, why this term? Once you have written this now I'll explain in this. Tell me, why this term barrier? Why they have used the term barrier? Barrier means occlusion. Means these contraceptive methods, these barrier contraceptive methods, they basically prevent the live sperm from meeting with the ovum. Okay. Now, what is the advantage of this type? The advantage is that there will be absence of side effects caused by something like hormonal pill or intrauterine device. They will be having some side effects. Whereas barrier methods, they have very much lesser side effects in comparison to them. But barrier methods require a higher degree of motivation from the uterus. because they have to be used again and again. So high degree of motivation is required for the barrier method. So the first barrier method is condoms. Now condoms can be male or female. Now what is the popular type of condom supplied by the government of India? That is Nirodh, N-I-R-O-D-H. N-I-R-O-D-H. Write the spelling. N-I-R-O-D-H. That is the one supplied by the government of India. So, this condom will not only prevent pregnancy, but will also prevent sexually transmitted diseases. How will you use it? The air has to be expelled from the head of it, and to make room for the ejaculate, and then the condom must be held carefully, and then the condom has to be put carefully on the erect penis. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of condoms? The advantages are that they are easily available, they are safe, inexpensive, the same thing. They are easy to use, no side effects, they are easily disposable, and the also major side advantage is that they prevent sexually transmitted diseases. And disadvantage is what of condom? Disadvantage is that it can slip off and it interferes with the sexual intercourse sensation. Achha. What are condoms made of? Condoms are made up of latex, and which is the from what company they are made? They are made by the Hindustan Latex of Trivandrum and London Rubber Industries of Chennai. Hindustan Latex of Trivandrum and London Rubber Industries in Chennai. Next, we talk of female condom. Female condom is made up of polyurethane. Okay, and it has got an internal ring and it has got an external ring. Okay, next we come to diaphragm. Now, diaphragm, it is also known as Dutch cap. The size is very important in case of diaphragm, because it has to be placed according to the size of the vagina, of the vaginal opening of the female. And spermicidal jelly should always be used along with diaphragm. This diaphragm needs spermicidal jelly. It has to be used with spermicidal jelly. The advantage is absence of risk and medical contraindication. Disadvantage is that after delivery, it can only be used after the uterus and is fully inverted. Next is vaginal sponge. I am removing these parts of the chart. What is vaginal sponge? It is also called Today. The brand is Today. Okay. And it is made up of polyurethane foam sponge, and it is generally containing nonoxynol 9. This vaginal sponge contains nonoxynol 9. Then we are talking about the chemical methods. Now, these chemical methods are not recommended by professional agents. By doctors, generally they tend to avoid these chemical methods. Next, I'll talk in detail about intrauterine devices later on. Next are hormonal contraceptives. Hormonal contraceptives can be oral pills or depot preparations. So combined oral pills will be having estrogen and progesterone. Progesterone only pill will be having plain progesterone. Post contraceptive pill, that is post coital pill, it is basically morning after pill, and it is to be used within 72 hours of the of the unprotected sexual intercourse, this post contraceptive pill has to be used within 72 hours to be effective. What can be done? What is the post contraceptive methods can be used? It can be hormonal, which is Levonorgestrel 0.75 mg tablet. Okay, or it can be Mifepristone 10 mg once within 72 hours. It can be Mifepristone, Mifepristone 10 mg, or it can be Levonorgestrel 0.7 mg. Levonorgestrel 0.75 mg. Okay, this is post contraceptive pill. Next, there are male pill. MP stands for male pill. What is the male pill? Male pill is Bassipol. This is the male pill. Then we come to injectables. Injectables can be progesterone only injectables, which include DMPA, D-4-methoxyprogesterone acetate. It can be DMPA, which is D-4-methoxyprogesterone acetate. It contains 150 mg every 3 months. DMPA is 150 mg at the rate of 3 months. Every 3 months, you have to take 150 mg DMPA. It will be, its action mechanism of action is suppressing ovulation. It suppresses basically ovulation. That is its mechanism of action. And it does not affect lactation. Next is NOR18-NET-N. NOR18-phenone enanthate. It is given intramuscularly 200 mg every 60 days. So next is norethisterone enanthate, NETN, which is given intramuscularly 200 mg every 60 days, and DMPA is given 150 mg every 3 months. DMPA suppresses ovulation. Okay, now this NETN also prevents ovulation. Now, how will you administer both DMPA or NETN? How will you administer it? It has to be given within the first 5 days of menstruation. Both DMPA and NETN, it has to be given within the first 5 days of menstruation. Where will you give them? Both are given deep intramuscular in the gluteus maximus, and the injection site should never be massaged following the injection. Next is DMPA subcutaneous. DMPA SC. So DMPA subcutaneous. What we are giving here is 104 mg of DMPA at 3 months interval. We are giving 104 mg DMPA at 3 months interval. So, these are the injectables. Next are subdermal implants. Subdermal implants are what? Are basically nerve plants. It has got 6 sialastic capsules, 35 mg each, containing levonorgestrel. 6 sialastic capsule with 36 mg levonorgestrel each. Nerve plant has got 6 sialastic capsules with 36 mg levonorgestrel each. And then there is another one, NOR plant R2. This is one. Another one is NOR plant R2, in which two small rods are put beneath the forearm, and both provide protection for 5 years. These are the subdermal implants, NOR plant and NOR plant R2. Next, we go on to post-conceptional methods. Menstrual regulation, menstrual induction, oral abortifacient and abortion. Oral abortifacient are Rugal Ucla 486, that is Mifepristone, along with Misoprostol. So the commonly used regimen is Mifepristone 200 mg orally on day 1. Mifepristone 200 mg oral plus Misoprostol ml vaginally immediately. Oral abortifacient is Mifepristone 200 mg orally plus Misoprostol 800 μg vaginally. This Misoprostol can be given immediately or it can be given within 6 to 8 hours. The patient is encouraged to follow up 14 days after the administration of this oral abortifacient and is then asked to do an ultrasonography. Next, the different rules of oral abortion are given, which you have read already in forensic, so I'm not repeating here. Next is others. The others technique are number 1, abstinence. Sexual abstinence, complete sexual abstinence basically represents suppressing a natural force. So that can lead to psychiatric problems even, or nervous breakdown or temperamental changes. Next is coitus interruption. Park describes coitus interruption as the oldest method, voluntary method of fertility control. Coitus interruptus, Park describes it as the oldest method of voluntary fertility control. Next is safe period. Safe period is the method, is also called calendar method. The safe period method or rhythm method is also called calendar method. Safe period, rhythm method or calendar method, it was given by Ogino. In this what happens, we know that ovulation occurs between the 12 to 16 days. So ovulation between 12 to 16th day of the cycle occurs from 12 to 16 days. So what we are doing, we avoid intercourse from the 8th to 22nd day. So we just avoid SI from 8th to 22nd day. So this is cyclical method by Ogino. This has been criticized as being a programmed sexual method, and there can be wrong calculations. In case of wrong calculation, it will lead to failure of contraception. Then there is breastfeeding. Breastfeeding basically provides lactational amenorrhea, and menstruation is absent, so it protects against childbirth also. It acts as a natural method of contraception. Next is birth control vaccines. This is the latest research is going on by, this is the latest technique, and how it will produce birth control vaccines. Basically, vaccines will be produced against beta HCG. People are targeting to produce vaccines against beta HCG. Those are birth control vaccines. Next are Natural Family Planning Method, NFPM. First is Basal Body Temperature Method. What we are doing here is that we know that due to progesterone, at the time of ovulation, body temperature rises by 0.3 to 0.5 degrees centigrade. Okay, why it happens due to progesterone? So, now in the morning, the patient gets up and checks the body temperature. If it is 0.5 to 0.3 to 0.5 degrees centigrade higher, then it is snacking, she is ovulating, and this rise in temperature is due to progesterone, and she avoids sexual intercourse that those days. Next is cervical method. Cervical mucus method is also called Billings method or ovulation method. Here what is happening, we know that cervical mucus becomes watery, resembling egg white or smooth slippery profuse at the time of ovulation. After ovulation, under the influence of progesterone, the mucus thickens. This basically method says that under estrogen and progesterone, both hormones are there, progesterone thickens the mucus, whereas estrogen thins it. So, by under Billings method, the mucus becomes thin and watery. So, after ovulation, at the time of ovulation, under this method, we see that the cervical mucus is thin. Why it is thin? Because it is under estrogen control. Next is symptothermic method. Symptothermic method basically says don't rely on any single method. Do a mixture of all the methods and according to that, use. That is symptothermic method. So we have completed all the we have completed all the temporary methods. Now we move on to the terminal methods of birth control. Okay, so sterilization. So what are the guidelines of sterilization? Guideline is age of husband should not be less than 25, nor should be over 50. The husband is less than 25, greater than 50, then you should not do. The husband age should be greater than 25, but less than 50. Okay? So the age of the husband should be greater than 25, but less than 50 years. Next, the age of the wife should be greater than 20 years but less than 45 years. Next, they should have 2 living children at the time of operation. At the time of sterilization, the couple should have 2 living children. Next, if the couple has 3 living children, then this age restriction which we had put, this greater than 25 but less than 50 for husband and for wife, greater than 20 but less than 45, this age restrictions can be relaxed if number of children is 3, if it is more than 2. So now we move on to male sterilization. These are the criteria for before doing sterilization. Next, we move on to male sterilization. Male sterilization is basically vasectomy. Okay, and cost wise, which is cheaper, vasectomy or tubal ligation? The answer is vasectomy. Next, what will be the advice after vasectomy? After vasectomy, the patient is told that he is not fully sterile immediately after the operation. So, up till 30 ejaculations, that is 8 weeks, you should use some other concomitant, other methods of contraception. Because up to 30 ejaculations or 8 weeks is not fully sterile. Next, he is told to avoid taking bath for the next 24 hours. For the next 24 hours, avoid taking bath. Then, wear scrotal support or long boat for 15 days. Wear long boat for 15 days, scrotal support, and avoid cycling and heavy weight for 15 days. Avoid cycling for 15 days. And stitches are removed on the 5th day. Stitches are removed on the 5th day. Next, we move over after female sterilization. We move over to evaluation of contraceptive methods. How to evaluate contraceptive methods? Evaluation of contraceptive methods. One is Pearl's index. Pearl index, which basically says failures per 100 woman years, failures per 100 woman years of exposure. Means it is basically total number of accidental pregnancies by total months of exposure into 1200. It is basically total number of accidental pregnancies by total number of months of exposure into 1200. So that is Pearl's index. That is failure rate per 100 human years. So if I give you an example, if I say that the failure rate of 10 per 100 woman years, means if I say Pearl's index is 10, then that means that in the lifetime of an Android woman, about 1/4 or 2/5 of the accidental pregnancies would result since average fertile period of a woman is 25 years. Okay, so now tell me, how many minimum number of months need to be seen before some conclusion can be given? Minimum 600 months need to be observed before a firm conclusion can be measured. Another method is life table analysis. Next, is the concept of unmet need. What is unmet need? From the name only you can understand unmet. So, unmet needs. The needs which are not met. Unmet. So, basically needs which are not met. And this is the meaning, na? Normal English only, this is the meaning. What is unmet need? It is the needs which are not met. So, it has been seen, what is the concept? It has been seen that contraceptive knowledge, attitude and practices, in contraceptive knowledge, attitude and practices, there is a wide gap between knowledge and practice. Means, there is a cap gap. Means, contraceptive knowledge, attitude and practices, what we call as cap. Contraceptive knowledge, attitude and practice. Means, it was seen that many people know about contraception, but they do not use it. So this is called cap gap. Means, in spite of knowing, they do not use it. Okay, so why this unmet need was there? So this question was arising because from the research, it was found that the women, although being sexually active, they did not want to get pregnant. But in spite of not wanting to become pregnant, still they did not use contraceptive methods. They knew about the contraceptive methods, but they still did not use it. So it was a mystery. In spite of knowing, why they are not doing. So the question came, why? Why, in spite of not knowing, they were not using it? The answer was that the contraceptive methods the contraceptive methods were inconvenient. They felt they did not have adequate information. They were afraid of side effects. These are the reasons why there was unmet need. Now, as they tell me, adolescent. How does WHO define adolescent? WHO defines adolescent as 10 to 19 years. That is the definition of adolescent. A person between 10 to 19 years, according to WHO, is an adolescent. Now, I have told about intrauterine device, but I did not discuss about them. So now I go back to the topic of intrauterine device. Intrauterine devices are basically two types, non-medicated and medicated. So the non-medicated are often referred to as first generation IUDs. So they can be divided on the basis of generation. So I am talking first about the first generation IUDs. First generation IUDs were non-medicated. First generation IUDs were non-medicated. They are usually made up of polyethane. Okay. And example is Lipus loop. That is the best example of first generation IUD. This Lipus loop had a double S shape. And it had got barium. Suppose this is the shape. There was a shape, and here barium was there. So it was barium tipped basically to allow X-ray observation. It was double S shaped barium tip. The tip has barium, and the tail. It also had a tail for easy removal. You can pull it simply if you want to take it out. We'll simply pull it. And Lipus loop existed in four sizes. A, B, C, D, and which is the largest? D was the largest, means this is the increasing order of size. So the largest was size D. And obviously the larger ones were used by multi-parasomers. Next, I talk of second generation IUDs. Second generation IUDs are basically copper IUDs. Okay, basically they contain copper. The numbers on the surface, the examples are copper tea 200, copper tea 388, copper tea 220. See, now the number, basically this number they basically denote the surface area of the copper that is present, means the surface area is square millimeter on the device. Now this copper T 200 has a lifespan of 4 years, copper T 380A has a lifespan of 10 years, okay, and there is another one, Nova T, that is also second generation, that has a lifespan of 5 years, okay. The next, this copper T 380A basically stands for AG, that is silver. Copper T 380A has a silver coat for which copper wire is wrapped. The center is silver and on the center the silver wires are wrapped. Now if I ask you, what are the advantages of putting copper? Advantage is that the expulsion rate is less, it is easier to fit in, lesser side effects, better contraception. These are the basic side advantages. Now third generation IUDs are basically hormone containing IUDs. Okay, the most commonly used is Pojasert. Pojasert. It has got 38 milligram progesterone. It releases progesterone at the rate of 65 microgram per day. Lifespan of 1 year. It is the most common third generation IUD. Okay. Then there is another one which is called LNG20. It is called Myrina and it has got 20 microgram LNG, lifespan of 10 years. Next, is if I ask you that the National Family Welfare Program, which all copper tea are used under the National Family Welfare Program, it subsidizes using copper tea 200B and copper tea 380A. National Family Planning Welfare Program subscribes the use of copper tea 200B, which has a lifespan of 4 years, and copper tea 380A, which has a lifespan of 10 years. Which is what I am sure you have seen, copper tea 300B. Like this. The red ones are the copper and the green part is the body. So this is the copper tea 200B. This has got a lifespan of 4 years. And which is the copper tea 380A? property 380A is this one. This property 380A. I'm sure you have seen them. This property 380A, this property 200B. These are basically promoted by the National Family Welfare Program. Property 200B 4 years, this 10 years. Next is, what are the advantages of IUD? Overall advantages of intake train device. Number one, simple. It requires no hospitalization, and once it put inside, it can be stay for long duration. It is cheap. It is reversible, free from metabolic side effects, highest continuation rate, and no need of continuous motivation. Motivation factor is less. These are the advantages. Now, if I ask you contraindications, absolute contraindications you need to know. Relative are also there, but absolute ones. You should know that one at least. Absolute ones are pregnancy, suspected pregnancy, it is contraindicated. Pelvic inflammatory disease is contraindicated. Vaginal bleed and of undiagnosed etiology is contraindicated. Ectopic pregnancy contraindicated, and CA is contraindicated. The absolute contraindications of PID of this intrauterine device is pregnancy, PID, vaginal bleed, ectopic pregnancy, and cancer. Now, if I ask you, who is an ideal candidate to insert IUD? Who is an ideal candidate to insert IUD? The answer will be, the person has one child, no history of PID, normal menses, monogamous, okay, and can be used, can follow up. So one child, no pelvic inflammatory disease, normal menses, monogamous, and follow up can be there. So those are the ideal candidates of IUD. Now, IUD is not recommended for women who have not had children or who have multiple partners because of the risk of PID. So, people who are not in a monogamous relation, who have multiple sex partners, their IUDs are contraindicated. And also children, people who do not have children, their also IUDs are contraindicated. Now, if I ask you, when you will insert the IUD? Timing. The timing is very simple. You can insert it during menstruation or within 10 days of menstruation of beginning. Because why? What is the advantage of doing it? Yeah, putting it, inserting it within during menstruation or within 10 days of beginning of menstruation? Because the cervical canal will be bigger. So the cervical canal will be open, will be greater, the diameter. So it will be technically easier to put it inside. And also the uterus is relaxed. So, contractions, which might tend to cause expulsion of the IUD, are less. Or it can be done during the first week after delivery. Or it can be inserted 6 to 8 weeks after delivery, or it can be inserted immediately after first trimester abortion. So when all you will do, will insert the IUDs, you can insert IUD during menstruation or within 10 days after menstruation. You can insert IUD first week after delivery, or you can insert IUD 6 to 8 weeks after delivery, or you can insert IUD after first trimester abortion. Next, I am asking you, what are the side effects and complications of IUD? The side effect, major side effect is bleeding, okay, and then other side effect is pain, pelvic infection, perforation, ectopic pregnancy. These are the main side effects. So, oh, and another topic, another small thing. What is Mala-D, Mala-L? What are the constituents? They contain liver norgestrel. ₹0.15 milligram, and they contain ethanol estradiol ₹0.03 milligram. Ethanol estradiol ₹0.03 milligram. Okay, now they are all quoted. Now Mala N, which is free of cost and which is costly? Well, none of them are costly, but which one you have to pay money and which one is free? Mala D costs ₹3. Mala N is free. So how will you remember Mala N is free? Free is basically no money. So N for N. Mala N is no money. So free. So Mala D has a packet of 20 pills, of which 21 are OCPs, total quantity pills, and 7 round film coated tablets are basically 60 milligram ferrous cumarate. So basically out of 28 pills, 21 are oral contraceptive pills, 7 are basically ferrous, 50 milligram is ferrous cumarate. So this brings